Welcome to the 18th episode of Silver Lining for Learning. My name is Punya Mishra, and I'm Associate Dean and Professor at the Mary Lou Fulton Teachers College at Arizona State University. I want to welcome everybody who's following on our YouTube live channel. Most of the people know about Silver Lining, but essentially what we are trying to do is take a different look at this disruption that we are currently undergoing. I'm joined, of course, by my friends and partners in crime, Kurt Bonk, Xuange Chen, Chris Didi, Scott McLeod, and Young Zhao. Today's edition is hosted by me, Punya, Kurt, and Zhao, while the others are working the back channel. I was just looking at the data. Our YouTube videos now have been viewed by, have had almost 6,800 views. So that's awesome. We also have a pretty active website with guest blogging. And I really recommend those of you who haven't been there to go and check it out. I just posted a blog post this afternoon. So without further ado, jump into our guests today. I'm thrilled to have Miri Shonfeld and Eli Shmueli with us today from Israel. Both are close friends, and we were just talking before the show started that exactly a year ago, I was there in Israel with them. And they were wonderfully gracious hosts, and I really treasured and the time that we had together. So it's a sort of a double pleasure to have you on the anniversary of that, to host you this way rather than actually physically host you. Would it have been fun as well? I will let them introduce themselves, so I'll be very brief. Miri is currently head of technology, education, and cultural diversity at the Moffat Institute and a faculty member in the graduate program in technology education at Kibbutzim College. She has done a lot of work in online learning environments. Of particular interest to me is the work that she's been doing around intercultural education in this online space. Eli Shmueli is the director of METAL. It's an inter-university center for e-learning. So it creates these partnerships and connections between higher education organizations, particularly around technology. With that, I will actually pass the baton to Miri to tell us a little bit more about herself. And then I guess it's Eli. Kurt, is that the right sequence that we have right now?
So just let me add that you'll hear a lot about collaboration, intercultural links between universities and schools and school partnerships and professional development and consortia. So it's all about getting people to work together and collaborate and share. And you'll hear that theme throughout this session. I had the fortunate privilege to be with Miri 15 years ago or so. So we both graced her land and were impressed with what she's been able to do with teacher training with technology. And Eli is going to wow us even more when he shows us some things that are going on there in METAL. So Miri, you want to take over?
Okay, so good afternoon and good night and good morning. Depends where you are. And yes, I will share a short presentation. Let me start with this. So first of all, my background is the real background of the Kibbutzim College in Tel Aviv. But you can see that it took part maybe 5-6 months ago, because in this time you can't see students sitting on the grass. It's really something that we would like to have again in our campus. And the real place where I stay most of the time now is Zoom International. And I think that most of you stay in this atmosphere. So it's a very global atmosphere. You can see one of my classes here in technology and education at the Kibbutzim College. So this is the other place where I work, the Moffat Institute, which is a unique place for professional development for teacher trainers, educators, and also there, their work is very limited to Zoom, not much face-to-face. And you can see that we started on March and the peak was on April, but we still on May and June stay with the Zoom, mainly Israeli participants, but we have also participants from other countries. And the main point that I would like to stress today is the promise of online learning. And this is the global online classes where we can connect between different cultures, different places, different countries. And the model that we developed at the Tech Center is a model to connect between students from different cultures. And in this model, we try to bring people from low trust level to high trust level. And of course, everything is working gradually. When we start from very simple online platforms and we go up to virtual worlds, we start with textual communication going to audio communication, and then we can do visual communication, also a simple level of collaboration till we get to synergetic collaboration. And of course, level of thinking, getting from very simple low-level thinking assignment and going up to high-level thinking assignment. And this is the way that we can get groups to high trust level. And of course, the teachers, the instructors, they come with their class to the project, and then we mix the classes, and each of the instructor will moderate groups from other cultures, other classes, and this is the essence of the tech model. We work also in virtual worlds. Here you can look at my avatar, which is not the everyday appearance in my real life, but this is the idea that you can change your appearance and you can feel the same as others while you are in virtual world, and you can increase your empathy to other cultures. We work also with the social networks. This is the NIR network, where students can write in Hebrew and it will immediately change it to other language. Here you can see Hebrew to Arabic, but of course you can change it to other languages as well. Here you can see one of my international project, the Koji project, which is an online collaborative learning project for Hungarian students, German students, and Israeli students. And here is the auditorium of the Kibbutzim College in Second Life, where we meet with the University of Texas in Austin. And I think this is the 10th year that we do the project, which is a game-based learning project. At the beginning of, let's say at the end of 2019, we met at Quebec with the Edu Summit project, and we developed the model that looked at the project like the tech model and others, and we try to understand what are the interaction between all the components of the learners and what are the basic skills that we need to give to our students. And of course, we spoke also about social justice, which is so important these days, because we know that millions of students and pupils stay at home and they are unable to connect to our online projects. I would like to ask you a very important question. Do we need to study online learning and online teaching? Of course, if you look at the people here, you must agree with me that no one will jump to the water without studying how to swim, and no one will take skydiving without learning how to do it. So I think it's very important to explain that before we took all the teachers, millions of teachers, to teach online, and this is what happened at the last 4 months, we have to teach them how to do it. So some countries took 1 week to teach them, the others even 1 day, and they were just started to work online. And I think this is the main problem. Of course, it's very simple and enjoying for young children when they stay at home and they are able to communicate. And also it is good for the old generation at the lockdown when they were able to communicate with their grandchildren. But for teachers to teach, it's not an easy task. Therefore, I would like to suggest to study about it. And this is one of my books that I edited together with David Gibson, Collaborative Learning in a Global World, where you can read more about collaborative challenges and the ways to do it. And also I would like to relate to intercultural education. So in next June, 2021, and we all hope that we will be able to meet face to face in Israel. We have the IAIE conference, and this week we send the call for proposal, and all of you are invited to submit abstract. So this is in short my presentation. Bonk, we can't hear you.
Bert, you're on mute.
So I said we already have one question coming through YouTube. Punya or Young, do you have a question to ask, or should we shoot the one to her from YouTube?
Actually, I mean, I think the question, I mean, I will just expand on that question a little bit. So Miri, I know you've been doing some really fascinating work around intercultural collaboration and work. And this is particularly, I think, significant given sort of the geographical location of Israel and the Middle East and all the tensions and all that are there. So if you could speak a little bit to that, the different population that you have been trying to make these bridges with. Second, the question that came on the chat was this idea of using avatars for developing empathy. Firstly, Anne asked if there are any studies or research projects on this. And I can also see on the chat, there's Chris sort of commented that the idea of using avatars can both have positives and negatives in terms of stereotyping or stuff like that. So if you can speak a little bit around that sort of broad array of issues, that would be great.
Well, it's not our, according to your program, Kurt, but I think the best answer will be to show the video clip, because it will show the different cultures in Israel. So maybe I can answer with the video clip. I think it's a better answer than words. Is it fine with you?
You have it ready and to go? Let's.
Yeah. So I think it will be the best answer instead of answering. Just a minute, I will.
And this is going to be a 4-minute video for our audience, just so they're aware. Approximately 4 minutes, and it goes by rather fast. So, and we did some sound checks. You might need to turn down your audio, but we'll see. It might come through a little bit loud. Oftentimes video does
in
got it there. Oh, you got it muted.
Okay, just a minute.
decided that I want to do something between Arabic colleges, religious colleges, and our college, the Kibbutzim College, which is a secular college.
The method behind it is people to meet together with other people who they wouldn't normally meet, but in a virtual world. A virtual world is the place where you're an avatar and you don't feel threatened. You don't have to meet face to face, and you can gradually get to know that person. And take your time to get to another person, to hear the other person's story.
Just seeing them online, all of them joining ideas, discussing, without thinking of the complexity of the world outside, just being kids, dancing and talking and laughing and doing the very basic human kind of things, but together. This moves me a lot.
The idea is to collaborate online, have a group of friends online that you work with them, and then meet them.
בהתחלה חשבתי שאני לא אכיר אף ילדה שם או אף חברה, ועכשיו כשנפגשנו אז התחברתי לכמה בנות.
וגילינו שאנחנו דומים. ממש הופתעתי לגלות שהם גם אוהבים לשחק וגדעים לשחק מחניים כמו אנחנו משחקים בבית הספר שלנו.
I was surprised because they were very interesting and nice. I found out that exactly like me, they like sports and all kinds of other stuff that I do.
לאט לאט התלמידים מתחילים לדעת ולהבין שכל מה שנודע להם קודם זה לא ממש מדויק ואמיתי. כשאנחנו נפגשים ומתחילים לדבר ומתחילים לראות אחד את השני, זה אחרת לגמרי.
Some people are born with bundles of empathy, but most people aren't. And I think it's a skill we have to teach. Like we teach mathematics and English and science, you can help someone to be more empathetic, but you can only do it by giving them simulations and putting them in situations.
This program gives them a chance really to open up to other kids and to find out what's going on outside and to understand that they're just the same.
Now I feel the Jewish is a good people and all of them love us.
I see in the future that there's going to be peace between Arabs and Jews and they're not going to fight anymore.
What we are doing is a start, like a startup, and I think it will grow up in here in Israel and also in other places in the world.
My dream of this program that it widen to connect children from all over the world and they be much more open-minded and really have the excitement to meet different people, to search different people who think differently, who believe differently, because this enrich their world and this also open their mind to the world that can be much more beautiful than it is now.
Okay, so I don't know if I answered the two questions. One is about the situation in Israel. You could understand the educational system in Israel is separate for Jewish students and Arab students and also for religious students and secular students. So it's very important in Israel to connect between the different cultures. And we can do it online. It's very important that we have online. And let's say that these programs continued the same as it was before because it was online. The only issue that we couldn't meet at the end of the year, but it was the same. And I think that also about the question about empathy that Christidi asked, we try to teach empathy when we go online to the virtual world and let's say we give a child or a student a wheelchair to sit in and to understand what happened to handicapped people when they have to go when they have to go to the bus. It's a real process that no one of us who don't have those problems can understand. So this is the way we use the virtual worlds.
Miri, you are working with Elaine when I was there 15 years ago, and the other colleague from the Arab Asma. College. Yeah, Asma. All three of you, I met everyone there. So it's been 15, maybe 20 years you all have been working together. Can you say a little bit about how this has evolved? Were there some principles of learning or instruction that you tried out early, it didn't work? And maybe there's some tried and true, some things that you'd recommend if someone was developing a program of similar nature somewhere else in the world, whether it's Korea and North Korea or India and Pakistan or whatever. But what are some of those principles that come out that you'd like to share, and advice that you might have for others in doing something like this, whatever that advice might be?
First of all, I can say that it 15 years ago, when you were in Israel, it was the beginning of the program, and it came bottom up. The three of us were the head of ICTs in our colleges of education, and we decided to work together, and we did a small project with the students of education. And from that small project, one class that we did and something we worked with the faculty members, we have now, let's say about 5,000 students that work each of the semesters or the year long. And we learned a lot also from other countries. For example, we were in a connection with Professor Roger Austin from Ireland. I think Ireland is a good example. They have also a similar conflict between Catholic people and Protestant people. And we learned a lot from each other. That time he worked with children. We worked only with the students in the colleges. And I think that he continued with students, and we continued also from his experience also with the teachers and the pupils. And we teach the teachers how to do it online and collaboratively. And a few things that we learned, like at the beginning, we started with this project without having a deep experience for the teachers. And one of the things that we learned from him, that first of all, the teachers have to understand how to work online and how to work collaboratively. So we bring all the teachers for 3 days seminar, and we teach them how to do it. And I think if we go back to the point, is that we have to teach how to do it. And then, of course, a lot of challenges, but at the beginning, they have to study and they have to experience the same challenges that those students will follow them.
You mentioned to me that the professional development that you're providing at your college is the largest in the country. Can you give a sense of some of the numbers that are involved?
You mean the Moffett Institute?
Yeah. Yeah, how many teachers have you trained over the time that you've
started? Well, the Moffett Institute is, we are only part of it with the online collaborative learning. The Moffett Institute, I think, have a lot of face-to-face training, and I'm not sure about the numbers. I think thousands of faculty members and teachers that came to the professional development, but I don't know really the numbers.
Punya, do you want to jump in?
Actually, I was just thinking we are almost at 2:54. That might be a good time to bring in Eli to talk a little bit, introduce a little bit about the work that he's been doing, and then we can then weave the conversation between all of these different topics. So Eli, please jump right in.
Thank you. I will share my presentation. Thank you, Punya, thank you, Kurt, for inviting me. I'm really glad to be here. So I'm Eli Shmueli from Meital, the Israeli Inter-University Center for E-Learning, and I would like to say a few words about Meital, just to know this organization. It's a kind of a consortium, as Kurt mentioned in the beginning, that fuel, boost, promote, and advanced e-learning education technology. in Israeli Higher Education Institute through a national and international project in collaboration. We have nine universities that all universities in Israel are partner with Meital or members, and around 20 to 25 colleges, academic colleges. So this is almost, it's actually more than, or it's around half of the colleges in Israel that are involved in Meital, and we have some other actions or activities that support the others, but they are, those are members. Our main activity during the year, it's actually to create a community that works together and share knowledge, mostly in online education, and to share and use and reuse content between them and try to promote the collaboration between those communities all together. And we have some kind of, we call it kind of consortium agreement of technologies to support those communities or those institutes and help them to use that technology and to use it and to promote the teaching and learning in the campuses. This is what we do usually during the year and before the COVID-19 that I will say in a few minutes about it. We have a lot of development staff members and teachers to support them during the years in different aspects of learning technologies, such as we have a working group that learning environment, new technologies, video courses. And we have some leading teams that deal with research and information, techno-pedagogical aspects, copyrights, learning analytics, and et cetera. So it's actually all the important things that we realize and see that the community needs, we try to promote during the year. As I said, research, instruction, we'll move to the other slide. And during the COVID-19, Meital was involved in some aspect. At the beginning, we realized that we need to support this, we need to support the institute in a different way. And we, at the beginning, had a license and agreement to have some kinds of tools that support them to move from the face-to-face learning and teaching to the online. So we had more than 25 institutes that have Zoom through Meital agreement, but it was more than that. It was not just the synchronic Zoom solution. It was different kinds of tools, but Zoom is the most popular here in Israel at this day. So we used that at the beginning. Then we had the Meital website, a very central place that share knowledge and information to the community in different ways, and we try to support them that way to have the information around it. What's the tools and what's the methods and what kind of support they need, and to have a community that works together and share information in a critical situation that we had at the beginning in the COVID-19. Social communities and support communities. WhatsApp was a great, WhatsApp and Telegram was a great solution for that. A very quick information and question and answers that go through the communities. And the online webinar, we had more than 20-25 webinars during the two months at the beginning of the COVID-19. And in a different aspect, with special people, with case study, with exam tools, with technology, whatever they need, we try to bring that, and this was open to the public, not just for the members. And that's where we had thousands of people or thousands of teachers that was involved in that. And this was a very a good way of supporting the community. During the COVID-19, we actually dealt with three challenges. The first one that we called the quick and dirty synchronized solution. We mentioned that we moved from face-to-face very quickly to the Zoom solution or any other synchronic solutions. But after 2 or 3 weeks, we realized that we need more than that. It's not enough to have exactly what we had in class on the synchronic mode. We had a lot of webinar during this process, but we learned that we need not just that, we need more than that, and we need asynchronic support that will work with the students during the before the session, during the session, and we have another terms of another kind of blended learning, not just not the regular one that we used to have at the beginning, years ago. We need to have online synchronic and asynchronic in the same class. So this is something that we learn, and we learn that we need more methods and more learning methods that will support the community and the teachers. And we try to support the Institute during this process. The third challenge was testing, evaluation, and assessment. We know that we cannot go into the classes, to the face-to-face learning, and we try to find the evaluation during the semester and some kinds of proctoring solution for that. And we tried to, this was the third challenge. And as I said—
Just Eli, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So that's been about 5 minutes. How about you take about five more minutes and try and, about five more minutes.
For the presentation or?
Yeah. There's been 5 minutes so far. How about another 5 minutes? You think you can get through in five more minutes?
Yeah, before that.
Okay.
We're on schedule. So as I said, the first challenge was to stay home, quick and dirty, and I mentioned that before. And we have several tools that support that. Synchronic Zoom was the most common, but we have all others. And as a consortium and a Meital kind of organization that work with all tools in all institute, we try to find more than one tool, and this is the list of the tools. As I said, the second challenge was to find the next step, synchronic learning, blended learning, and collaborative learning. And this is something that we work very hard to try to support the community and to see what we can do and what kind of learning method we can bring to the table. As I mentioned before, the second challenge, I'm not gonna go to that, but the third one was the test evaluation and assessment, the open that brings plagiarism, and the close, what we call close, is the proctoring, quiz and close question. And we have different tools that can support that. We don't have any agreement with all of them, but we can, we discuss it with the community, and each institute use different solution. I can tell you that these days, I think this is, most of the institute are using kind of a Zoom solution with a Moodle solution, the combination between them, and try to figure out how to solve this exam solution. And of course, evaluation and assessment that they can use during the semester and be part of the solution. We can see the numbers that more and more, we have more than we have a large number, 8,500 viewers per day in our website. Around 64% of them are new visitors that came into them our website during the crisis. We can see we had more than 3.4K people that reach our Facebook and our website during the COVID-19. And we can see a large number of participants or people that are visit our pages, and the numbers are raising during the process, and we can see that it's very important and significant for those participants. Again, we can see here the Facebook, and we can see that there was more than 20 events during this around two months, more than two a week, different kinds of events that we support the communities. And this is the numbers that we can see during the process. And it was really support the communities that share knowledge and information between them for a long, for very intensive activity between them.
Thank you, Eli.
So
we can maybe make those slides available for people who are interested. both sets, and the video's been shared. Have you shared the video link in the YouTube channel?
We can post the video link in the, once we post the blog, we update the blog post with this video, we can post that then. So that'll be fine. So Zhao, you haven't had got a chance to talk or ask questions, and I'm sure you must be bubbling with questions. So let it pass on to you.
Well, thank you. I was actually watching with great interest. And as you know that, because we call our show Silver Lining for Learning, that we're looking for the silver lining there. Apparently you both have done a lot around this issue. So I'm actually going to ask Chris Didi's question. Chris Didi was wondering about this, and I am actually too. When the COVID finally gets some solution, when it recedes, when it's gone, do you think you would do something differently from what you've learned during the crisis? What would you do differently? We can start from Miri and then we can go to Eli.
Well, I think that I will do it much bigger, and I put more forces to pursue all the, let's say, the people who are responsible for teacher preparation, and that it's very important to prepare teachers to do online collaborative learning. Let's say Israel is a small country, and people before the COVID time argued with us that online learning in Israel is not necessary. I think we invited it in order to so to convince everyone we don't have to discuss it today. So I think that I will try to do more of it.
So can I push that, Miri? Because right now in the US and almost every place, people are really struggling to plan for lessons in a few weeks. And so what would your advice be for these schools if they have to do purely remote, a mixture, or, you know, what would you suggest to them about remote learning? They saw remote learning, it's maybe online, maybe other ways. How do you think they can design a better learning environment without children in schools?
I think that the main problem of online learning, that children are alone in their house or their place, and collaborative learning, meeting their the other pupils, having a online collaborative learning will help to improve online learning, because otherwise it's the teacher and the students are there or are not there, but once they have their peers there, they will do it better.
Okay, thank you. Eli?
Yeah, I think, you know, in the in a national perspective, I think there is something's happened. We can see that, first of all, the management, the institute management, realized that we need this solution very, and we have to support that, and we have to invest in that and see how to have online learning as part of the learning in the campuses. We realize that, and we can see the change in the management. And we realize another thing, that we need more. It's not just a synchronic, simple synchronic mode. We need something more, more learning method that will be related, or will be something that in a different way that we did in class. We have to understand that the online environment, it's a little bit different than, it's a lot different than what we used to have. We know from the past. And we need different methods that support that. And we need a method to be the combination between synchronized and asynchronized. And we need it to be, and the session cannot be an hour and a half like we used to have. We need to understand all this, and we already start to understand that. And I think what the COVID did for us is that most of the people are actually involved in the online learning, you know, almost all the people. And this is something that we didn't know and didn't have a few, let's say, months ago. And this is this is a big change, what we call a digital competences. And this is something that brings most of the children, I think, and all of the students and teachers to this, to face it and try to work with that. And this is something that we didn't have a few months ago. So we have some benefits from that crisis that help us to understand how to build a better lesson, that we not, at least in Israel, people are talking about the combination between online session and face-to-face after the crisis. And we realized that the face-to-face should be, or the online should be, different than what we have. And I think this is three main important things that we learned. And we learned it, but we knew that we was involved. But it's not just us, it's the audience, it's the teachers, it's the management. This is more important, and the students that are part of that, and they actually realize that this is something that they need, and they have to be more open to that, and not just thinking it's the Open University, it's not part of our mission, or it's not part of our activity.
Ellie, you're mentioning Open, and I read in your bio, OER is prominent in working with people at Merlot, like Jerry Hanley, we talked about the other day. You have Merlot and OCW and some projects in Europe, the Erasmus project and open repositories and so forth. How do you get the uptake of OER? Is there a secret to that, to get faculty and staff and others to utilize what's out there and to evaluate what's out there and to share higher qualities? What have you found out?
I think that it's there's two points about it. One of them, I think it's the open issue. It's a process, and it started a long time ago with MIT. Let's say 20 years ago was the first project of open OERs, and we are, it's not in the end of the process, but in the middle of the process, that we go from OERs and then to the open courses and the MOOCs. It's part of the open access. And it's all something, it's not the infrastructure and the platform, it's more than actually the set of mind. People are willing to share and use and reuse more than they used to do it in the past. We can see different kinds of using, but I think it's something that we realize that if you will share your information and knowledge, it's for your benefits as well, not just for the one who use it. And this is the one point of that. And I think it's something that, I think that the MOOCs is part of that process. Actually, the OER start 20 years, now we are in the MOOC trend and we are moving forward to another aspect. And of course, the issue of public money, and that goes back to the public and the openness and everything. This is something that always part of that. But I think we realize in the COVID, another thing it's that it's very important is the one that actually we need good content. And as when we realize that you cannot go into the class with one presentation and try to have or to go to the online and have the same presentation. You need to prepare your lesson better. And when you prepare your lesson better, you need a good content. And a good content, it's not just the MOOC from one side, because people don't like to use the full MOOCs, but they like to use sometimes, it's easier for them to use OER or something that is smaller. It supports their teaching and it supports their activities, and they're sometimes feel better to use that way. So I think it's connecting to the COVID as kind of a good quality content that we like to use.
Okay,
thank you.
Go ahead, Punya.
Kurt, yeah. So I want to come back to something, Miri, that you spoke of, and a question that also similar that was in my mind popped into the YouTube channel. So when you talk about this fact that, you know, that one of the concerns is that the children are at home, sort of isolated from sort of the social interaction, has there been any attempt to sort of rethink the role that parents or sort of the more local can play? Because to me, it seems, and I think in our previous discussion that has sort of come up, that that's another opportunity sort of to that COVID allows us to rethink. You know, at some level, it's if you call it a public school, but at some level, you know, we're like, okay, I send my kid there and they come back and my job as a parent is done. While this maybe allows for some new models for thinking about not just sort of synchronous, asynchronous, but who has a say in and a participation in the education of the child. So any sort of discussions, or do you see anything emerging in that area?
So first of all, I will start and say that I argue with Eli comment about content, and I think that it's not about content, it's about pedagogy. I think that the problem of online learning as it exists now is the pedagogy. I think that if teachers will know how to do online learning, it will be much better, much easier. And children and parents will enjoy the advantage of online learning. The problem is, in Israel, it was that at the first week, teachers didn't know how to do it. They just, as Eli said, send a PowerPoint presentation and assignments and things to do. And parents went crazy. It was a way that... one of the parents, it was a video that was passing all over the country. A mother that said, I'm getting crazy. I can't do the assignment.
She's in her car. She's in her car. I've seen that one, right?
Right.
Yeah, and the parents stopped the online learning for a few days. It was stopped for a few days because parents didn't want to take part in this mess, in these assignments. They didn't want to look at the presentation. They didn't want to study again. They wanted the teachers to have the kids, to get the kids the way to study, to learn. So I think that much more collaboration between institutes, between schools, between teachers will make it easier. So this is the first part of it. And also, I didn't speak about it, but before, but project-based learning. Children can't move at home from a presentation about history, another presentation about biology, another presentation. They need to find a project, an engaging project that they will start to work with their peers and do a lot of research and do self-learning. And this is very important. And this is something that I would like to teach all the teachers. And we know how to do it. I'm looking at you, Kurt and Punia, and we speak about it, and we need to bring teachers that know how to do project-based learning, collaborative studies. So I think this is the solution.
So thank you, Miri, for that. I don't know if you, Miri and Eli, had a chance to look at the one episode a couple of weeks ago, which we had these five students as guests, and they talked about the work that they were doing. And it ties in, I think, the only piece, Miri, that came out from the students' piece was exactly the project-based learning, collaboration, but I think it was driven by their own passions and interests. And I think that that is also part of sort of the mix that can emerge there. So Zhao, do you want to say something, or are you just agreeing with me? Okay. You're muted, so I just wanted to be sure. So there's one more question. I know we are getting tight on time. We are 3:19. So Eli, there was a question here for you. And I think that maybe you also got a chance to respond to Miri's point about pedagogy there. But the question was how to encourage the creation of good content, which is going beyond sort of versus replicating classroom practices, you know, which work face-to-face into an online environment.
Just before that, I'd like to respond to Miri. I think again, and we realized that, and we actually did it in one of the European projects that called Open Up to You or Up to You. And it's the pedagogy should lead. We understand that and we know that. We are technologies consortium kind of a techno pedagogical aspect, but we are realizing, we know that for a long time, that the pedagogical aspect should lead the process, and then we will find the technology that will support it. It can be a good content and it can be a good technology, but it's only in the end of the process. So we agree on that. And I think I mentioned that in my presentation, that the learning methods are, PBL can be part of it, but it can be any others that support the pedagogy needs. So it's so I agree with Miri as well. And of course, the content, it's another issue, but I think it's something that can support the needs of good teaching. You need a pedagogical aspect, you need a good content for that. So this is my remark about what we agree. And we, as I said, we had it in one of the European project, Horizon 2020 project, Up to University. It's actually tried to find, to support students from K-12 or high school to the university, to bring them to university with digital competence and other skills that they need for that. And that project we had at the beginning to think how to use that and how to promote it, but we realized that we will start from the skills, pedagogical aspect, methods, and then the tools. And this is the process that we had there, and I think we were using that in Israel. We had another session yesterday, or a few days ago, 3 days ago, actually. And we, with all the institute here in Israel, we discuss this issue and see what they need for the next, because we are in the end of the semester, and we realize that they need the pedagogical aspect to support the technology, and to actually to the pedagogical aspect, and then to find different technology for that. So this is something that came up from all the aspects. And sorry, Punya, about the content.
The question was how to encourage this creation of better content or better pedagogies, right?
Yeah, I think it's a good question, because we're always facing this issue. There is a lot of repository all over the world. There is Merlot, one of them. There is EduOER in Europe, a big one. That it's another repository or refertory that combine different content. But and the trouble is that, or the problem is that, we don't know exactly how the content is and what kinds of. So I think that what we are trying to figure is how the audience will rate it and be more involved. But these days there is a lot of other solution to create content in a better way. There is some technology that can support. So this, from the other hand, can support the creation of the content, like H5P and other tools that we have, or content builder in Merlot. There is different open tools that help teacher to create content. And if we are talking about OER, then the MOOCs, it's actually, as I said, the process, kind of a process that we mentioned, and the MOOCs are usually in a very good content. Some institutes are using that.
I'm just looking at the time. I know Zhao has a question, and then Chris needs to introduce. And I told you the hour just goes by before you know it. So Zhao, please.
So my question does not need to be answered. I just want to pose this for all of us, for all the audience to think about this, because I'm looking right now, massive changes. You know, where I am now, Eugene, Oregon, the district is thinking about running a district-wide academy for all the students. So right now, you know, students belong to institutions, belong to a school, a college, but actually learning, they can go everywhere. So for example, Miri's class can be completely global. So Miri, you can run a class of global, but how do people pay you? How do you do that? So I want to invite all of us, if COVID stays for another 2 years, what would be? I used to imagine for 1 year, if it stayed for 2 years, you know, all this visa issues, international issues, Because really, I was very impressed, Miri, with your effort, because I also think global understanding, cross-cultural understanding is key. What if we have institutions that offers to students in different places? Does this go to a school voucher system? Does means parents get more money? They decide to send wherever they want to send. They reorganize students locally. I don't know. My question is really, as that's why it doesn't need an answer, but I want us to think about this issue to say, if it breaks down the traditional schooling, which has been there for really for a long time, for developed countries, you know, 100, 120 years, and what might be if individual students, children, parents are making the education decisions, if they are no longer affiliated with one institution, what does this mean? That's what I was thinking about. Feel free to jump in, Pune. Now you control this. I'm back out.
Okay. All right. No, I think that's I think super fascinating. And what's the ultimate interesting irony in this is this, the need for global interconnection has never been more. And yet we are all stuck in place. We can't travel. And so it's almost like that is the fact that we are stuck in place is giving us the opportunity to do certain things that we couldn't do before. So I think that just, and I think this is a completely fascinating topic for us to think about. But I also know that we are sort of running short on time here. We're at 3:26. That is my time in Arizona. I'm sure it's 1 something in Israel, and so on, and close to 6:30 in where Chris, and then Chris has reappeared here. But to introduce the next episode. But before we go, I just want to take a moment to thank Miri and Eli for taking the time to join us, for sharing your examples and your stories with us. As we look across this pandemic and its impact across the world, one of the things, and I think I mentioned this in a previous episode at some point, that one of the things that it has done, sort of going back to sort of to Zhao's point, is has actually connected us across the world as this band of educators who have similar commitments, similar passions, driven by this sense of social justice, driven by this thing of developing the next generation of global citizens. So if one silver lining for me has been that I feel more connected to educators across the world, and I think a large part of it is for the work that people like you do. And so thank you so much for joining us today. And Chris, I'm going to pass it on to you.
I thank them as well. I want to thank Miri and Elliot for the practice and all the time. And I'll also mention Maha Bali's talk at the Online Learning Consortium is all about caring with technology and emotion and empathy. And it's free online to watch. It's from last month. So you might have seen it, Maha Bali's keynote at the Online Learning Consortium. So I'll throw it over to Chris.
Thank you, Kurt. Chris, please.
Well, let me join in thanking you for a terrific episode and a chance to share what the exciting things that are happening in Israel. I want to highlight our episode next Saturday, the 25th. We will be looking at Africa, and we have 3 experts from Africa who will be describing different kinds of exciting and innovative things happening on that continent. We will be at a different time next week. We'll be at 3 p.m. Eastern time, 2.5 hours earlier. So if you want to watch live, then please come earlier. But of course, you're welcome to watch the archive at any time. And I'm just very excited about the collection of episodes that we're generating from all across the world. And actually, I'm planning to use them as case studies in my fall teaching.
Thank you, Chris, for that. And I was just looking at the visitors who are guests who will be joining us next week. I think it's going to be a very exciting episode. So thank you for helping organize that. Thank you, of course, to all our visitors on the YouTube live channel. We have a pretty dedicated band who shows up every Saturday. I keep being surprised by the fact that they keep showing up. But I think that there is something we are adding to the conversation that they feel that this is part of something that they would like to do. So thank you, all of you, for that. And thank you, Miri and Eli, for joining us.
Thank you all,
thank you
and have a good night.